The moment you started observing reality, you hopelessly polluted any conclusions you might make about it. The Anthropic Principle guarantees that you are not seeing the universe in its most typical state. But used correctly, this highly controversial idea can be extremely powerful. So, how do you correctly use the Anthropic Principle? In 1543, our perspective of the cosmos was radically disrupted. Nicholas Copernicus presented his model for the solar system, which demoted the Earth from its position at the center of the universe to just one of several planets orbiting the Sun. As our astronomy improved, we realized that our Sun is a typical example out of hundreds of billions of stars in the Milky Way, and that the Milky Way is an ordinary galaxy among hundreds of billions of galaxies in the observable universe. The notion that we occupy neither a central nor a privileged position in the universe is called the Copernican Principle, after the guy who started it. It's extremely important. It allows us to study the distant universe, confident that its laws of physics are the same as we experience on Earth. It allows us to understand the origin of the Earth and the Milky Way by studying the ancient light of distant galaxies. The Copernican Principle became such a powerful tool that it took centuries for us to realize that it's wrong, or at least flawed. It states that we don't occupy a central privileged position, but that's only half true. Earth certainly isn't central, but it is privileged, and not at all a typical environment, nor perhaps is our entire universe. Our planet and our universe must have at least one non-typical quality. They must have been able to produce us, to give rise to living creatures that can observe it. This is the Anthropic Principle, and it seems to contradict the sacred Copernican Principle. Over the last two episodes, we talked about certain observations of the uniqueness, both of our planet and of the universe, and how these feed into two versions of the Anthropic Principle. Today, we're going to bring these ideas together with the Copernican Principle to see just how powerful and how misleading the Anthropic Principle can be. According to the original definitions by Brandon Carter, the weak Anthropic Principle states that we must live in a place and a time in the universe capable of supporting observers, in our case, a habitable biosphere. And the strong Anthropic Principle, which states that the universe itself must have the conditions necessary for producing environments that, in turn, produce observers. That means the fundamental constants and initial conditions of the universe must be just right to allow nice habitable planets to form. Let's just call all of this the Anthropic Principle. We necessarily observe from an environment capable of producing observers, be that environment a planet within a universe or a universe within a multiverse. By itself, this statement is uncontroversial, some would even say tautological. But things get interesting when you add the fact that our universe seems to have fundamental constants and initial conditions that seem extremely fine-tuned for the eventual formation of life. The Anthropic Principle permits a new explanation for this fine-tuning besides blind luck or design. If there are enough universes, or enough regions within this universe, and their properties can vary, then, even if the vast majority are lifeless, life-friendly universes can still show up, and we shouldn't be surprised that we find ourselves in one, even though Earth and a life-supporting universe might be quite atypical. This use of the Anthropic Principle is highly contentious. Many scientists find it extremely unsatisfying and lazy and unscientific. After all, it doesn't tell us why the fundamental constants take on the values they do, or why they may vary between universes, or even why there should be multiple universes. Some of the bad rap for the Anthropic Principle comes from a distortion of the idea. In the 1986 book, The Anthropic Cosmological Principle, John Barrow and Frank Tipler misinterpret the strong Anthropic Principle to mean that the evolution of observers somehow had some retrocausal influence on the initial formation of the universe. But this commits the same flaw in reasoning that the Anthropic Principle may solve. The principle is not causal. It just tells us to account for an observer selection bias when interpreting the nature of our environment. So, our finely tuned part of the greater cosmos doesn't have to have been custom built for us. The other common misuse is to assume that the anthropic principle allows for any degree of extreme fine-tuning of the properties of our own environment, regardless of the global distribution of properties. Here's an example originally laid out by Roger Penrose. The universe's most finely tuned parameter is its unthinkably low initial entropy. The incredible density of the Big Bang was a highly ordered state. All particles in the observable universe were packed together in a subatomic-sized dot. Everything interesting that's happened since, from the formation of stars and galaxies to the evolution of life, has been powered by the slow increase in entropy from that initial state. The universe will spend the vast majority of its perhaps infinite life in a state of extreme disorder and high entropy. Iron stars, black holes, and a mist of cold elementary particles, not very hospitable to life. The second law of thermodynamics tells us that entropy can only increase, which means extreme high entropy states must be the norm. In the full timeline of our universe, but probably also across the multiverse, if it exists. We certainly don't observe the universe in a typical observer-hostile state, and so it's tempting to use the anthropic principle here. Low entropy regions should be vastly less common than high entropy regions, but if they exist, we're going to find ourselves in one. But guess what? That statement is wrong. Or at least incomplete. The anthropic principle appears to fail here. But to understand why, we need to go all the way back to the Copernican principle. In fact, we need to bring these two seemingly conflicting principles together. And in doing so, we'll end up with a much more powerful version of the anthropic principle, one that will even make testable predictions. By the Copernican principle, we are most likely to observe a very typical environment. This is just a statement of probability. There are more typical environments than non-typical ones, so pick a random environment, and it's probably typical. But the anthropic principle tells us we must account for our status as observers when we interpret our environment, including the probability of being in it. So let's formulate a refined anthropic principle. We should expect to find ourselves in a typical region of the cosmos that is consistent with us being observers. And by cosmos, I mean the sum total of reality, be it universe or multiverse, that allows us to be in a rare observer-friendly environment, but tells us that we should be in the most typical of such environments. Our perspective on the cosmos might be a rare one, but it should be no more rare than is necessary to explain our existence. This refined anthropic principle gets really interesting when applied to our low entropy Big Bang. If low entropy regions happen just by chance fluctuations from a high entropy state, then the lower the entropy, the less probability of that region forming. For example, a fluctuation the size of a galaxy is insanely more likely than one the size of our observable universe. It's much easier to produce hundreds of billions of galaxy-sized fluctuations than a single fluctuation of hundreds of billions of galaxies. You surely don't need more than one galaxy to spawn a life-bearing planet, so there should be many more observers in small entropy fluctuations than in large ones. Our refined anthropic principle appears to fail here, but actually it doesn't. We've just witnessed the potential power of this principle. Under the assumption that our universe resulted from a simple random fluctuation in an otherwise high entropy cosmos, the anthropic principle predicts that we should be in the smallest such fluctuation that could produce us. Apparently we aren't, and so we can probably rule out a simple random entropy fluctuation as a sufficient explanation for our Big Bang. Or at the very least, we need extra physics. For example, we need the right initial density fluctuations to evolve and expand for the right amount of time, so that life would always be in big universes. If we then assume that the starting conditions for our universe were typical, that can tell us something about the physics of how universes are born. For the anthropic principle to be useful and not misleading, we need to be careful. philosopher Nick Bostrom has made valiant attempts to clean up what he calls anthropic reasoning in his book Anthropic Bias. In it, he defines, though doesn't invent, the self-sampling assumption, which states that, all other things equal, an observer should reason as if they are randomly selected from the set of all actually existent observers, past, present, and future, in their reference class. If there are a bajillion observers in the entire cosmos, you should consider yourself randomly selected from them. That means you're most likely a common type of observer and in a common environment in which observers can exist. The anthropic principle and the self-sampling assumption encourage Bayesian thinking. We should take into account what we already know, our priors, before assessing any probabilities. The prior is that we are an observer, but proper Bayesian thinking requires careful definition of priors. For example, Bostrom talks about observers in their reference class, but how do we know what our reference class is? Carbon-based sentient life? All conscious entities? Anything capable of thinking about the anthropic principle? Even with careful definitions, anthropic reasoning is difficult to use well, and that's evident in the bizarre predictions it can make, from Boltzmann brains, which we covered, to the doomsday argument, the idea that the self-sampling assumption predicts that the end of the world is nigh, which we'll cover soon, hopefully soon enough. The anthropic principle in its proper form is without question an important thing to take into account whenever we observe the universe. It's one possible explanation for why our planet and our universe appear to fit us so well, even if they weren't intentionally made for us. Douglas Adams put it best. If you imagine a puddle waking up one morning and thinking, "This is an interesting world I find myself in, an interesting hole I find myself in. It fits me rather neatly, doesn't it? In fact, it fits me staggeringly well. Must have been made to have me in it. This is such a powerful idea that as the sun shines in the sky and the air heats up and as gradually the puddle gets smaller and smaller, it's still frantically hanging on to the notion that everything's going to be all right because this world was meant to have him in it. Was built to have him in it. So the moment he disappears catches him rather by surprise. I think this may be something we need to be on the watch out for." Used well, the anthropic principle gives us a deep perspective on our place in the cosmos and can also be a powerful, albeit slippery, scientific tool. But misused, it can lead to unscientific conclusions, as can any tool in science. We'll come back to some of the wilder predictions of both good and bad anthropic reasoning real soon and talk about what you can know about your universe, given your privileged status as a typical conscious observer of space-time. Today we have a very special thank you to Dr. Alex Flournoy of the Colorado School of Mines. Dr. Flournoy, several of your students wanted to thank you for unlocking the mysteries of physics for them and to let you know that their thoughts are with you by sponsoring this video at the Big Bang level. Now, based on the very touching words they send to us, you're clearly some kind of hero whose superpower is to spread their vast knowledge of physics across the multiverse and unleash a Star Trek-esque science utopia here on Earth. Now, to speed that up, we've linked to your amazing lectures on particle physics and general relativity in the description. So, from your students and from everyone here at Space Time, we wish you well. Last week we talked about how the constants of nature seem to be fine-tuned for life in our universe, and how this may imply that there are countless universes beyond our own. Discussion in the comments was lively, to say the least. Many people had the following objection. They say that the universe isn't really fine-tuned for life or for observers because there could be many types of observer very different to ourselves that could potentially exist if the fundamental constants were different. Well, actually, fine-tuning arguments for the fundamental constants for the most part take that into account. We can probably assume that for an intelligent observer to emerge in any universe, that universe must be capable of forming complex structures, whether or not it looks like life as we know it. So, The universe needs to last for a reasonable amount of time, have stable regions and energy sources for those structures to form, and have some building blocks, whether or not they look like atoms as we know them. Much of the parameter space that the constants of nature could have taken eliminate one or more of these factors. So while there may be many small parts of that parameter space where observers can arise, most of it, and hence most universes, should be devoid of observers. A few of you pointed out that I missed one possibility. Perhaps the dials defining the fundamental constants were neither randomly set nor deliberately tuned. Perhaps there's some unknown physical principle that demands they have exactly the values that they do. Well, right, that's possible. But the point is that unless that principle is somehow connected to the universe later developing life and structure, why should it have landed on one of the rare combinations amenable to life and structure? It's just as easy to imagine a physical principle that gives you only one universe with an unavoidable combination of fundamental constants that was completely devoid of life. So, I still count this option as either getting lucky or that the later emergence of life was somehow retrocausal of the universe's knob setting. Between these options and the multiverse, I think I prefer the multiverse. Adlock Hungry makes a great point. Surely, if this were a Goldilocks universe, there would be life on almost every planetary body, even in this solar system. Well, that would certainly be true if such fertile universes were anywhere near as common as our relatively barren one. The self-sampling assumption says that we should assume that we are a typical observer. So, maybe the most typical observers are in relatively barren universes, and there are just way more of those universes. That may be telling us something about how the constants of nature get set. It may be improbable to get those constants fine-tuned for life, but the more fine-tuned they are, the more improbable. Keith Strang correctly points out that we also have to talk about the fine-tuning of parameters to get a multiverse in the first place. Physicists are struggling to make eternal inflation work without its own fine-tuning that may be just as bad as the fine-tuning needed for life in our universe. Well, that's a challenge, but inflation is still not so well understood, so it seems there's plenty of opportunity to solve this. If it can't be solved, then we should ultimately dismiss the theory. Enoch Kelfer has an idea for a physics problem. Iterate through the settings of the constants of nature and figure out the map of possible settings that support self-propagating pattern entities. In other words, find all the possible combinations of constants that can produce observers. Well, that sounds like a great challenge question. If anyone does this, they get a free universe and a t-shirt. Although if you can do this, you can probably also build your own portal gun and visit all the universes you want.